some of them have come up weeping because the presence of God was here in a special way, and they wept their way through salvation. I tell you, the Spirit of God is moving in a special way. Tonight we're going to start at 7 o'clock, our final time, and so I ask you to get on the phone, bring a friend, and let's make this last night a great night where people are challenged with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we had a wonderful time with Mike Weave from Big Daddy Weave on Wednesday night. It was a great night, and the Spirit of God was here in a special way. And people could feel that. People could sense the presence of God here in a special way. There was a part in the concert where they gave an opportunity for the people that were here to forgive those that had hurt them, offended them, abused them, and so right in the middle of the concert, the word went forth, and people were given a chance to allow God to heal them of their hurt. There was a very special moving of the Spirit during that time. I had somebody that came to me last night and told me that part of their family, when they were here, took that very seriously because they had been abused as a child. And they grew up still in the chains of that experience. You know, there are people that who have had been damaged when they were very young, and nobody tells them how to get over that. Nobody tells them how to walk away from it, to make it something in their past. But so many people carry that with them through their whole lives. And that was the case of one person that was here on Wednesday night. All the other relationships that they were in have been affected because of the damage that had been done to them. On Wednesday night, they chose to forgive. On Wednesday night, they allowed the Holy Spirit to bring healing to that damaged emotion. And the testimony that came to me was that something broke on that night, and they feel as though they had a new beginning. And today they are walking free. They're walking free from the condemnation. They're walking free from the hurt and the offense. I want you to know, because this person was not the only one, if you're walking around and still carrying the hurt of a broken relationship, maybe somebody that took advantage of you when you were a child, and you're still walking around with a limp, you're still inside, you're bound to that experience. I want you to know that there's freedom in Christ. I want you to know that Christ is our healer, and you don't have to walk around your whole life being hurt because of what somebody else has done against you. We don't have to wait for Daddy Weave to come back. We don't have to wait for a time. You can be healed today. In the presence of God, you can let go. You can become free. And I know those who have suffered that way, it sounds impossible. But I want you to know, with Christ, all things are possible. And Jesus died so that you can be set free from the pain of that experience in your life, of that rejection in your life, of those that you're still carrying the offense of other people. I want you to know that in Christ there's healing for you and that you can be set free. Can I hear a good amen? Amen. Praise God. Well, I decided that since we're having our drama this week, that today I would preach on heaven or hell, because that's the topic of the weekend. And so I'm going to speak about that. And I want to apply it to us today. We who, most of us, have a relationship with God, most of us are on our way to heaven. So what does a message about hell, how does that affect us? Because we're going to heaven. So I'm going to apply it not to them, not to the people that will be here tonight, but I want to make an application of it to us so that we can, it will inspire us. In John 3:16, it says, "For God so loved the world." In fact, let's read it together. Is it on the screen? Let's read it together. Everybody say, "For God." Shall not perish. You know, that's a reference to hell. For those that believe on Him, for those who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, shall not perish. There is a way out of the judgment of God that He has made for us so we can follow Him and so that we can be free from the fear of eternal hell. But have eternal life is a reference to heaven. And so in this very familiar verse of Scripture, we have a message of hell and we have a message of heaven. And people quote this and without really realizing that the Bible is talking about heaven and hell and how important it is for us to understand that the Bible is filled with scriptures about heaven, about hell, and about heaven, about the judgment of God on those that refuse to accept Him, about the lake of fire, about those that reject Christ and the sacrifice that He made for us. I want you to know that the Bible is filled with scriptures about hell. I don't know of anybody that wants to go to hell. Oh, there may be those that make fun and say, I want to go to hell because that's where all my friends are going to be. They have no idea. They have no idea what they're saying. They have no idea about the torment. Because hell's a place where we'll suffer torment for all of eternity. I don't want you walking out of here thinking that hell's just going to be for a short period of time. I want you to know that hell is eternal. And although you'll never die, you'll still live in eternal torment all the days of eternity. Others think that or wonder if how could a God of love send anybody to hell? What kind of a God are we trying to portray? Because so many times we talk about how much God loves us, and we preach that message of God's love, and then you come on Sunday morning, and last Sunday in October, And you find out we're going to be talking about hell and how God is going to judge people at the end of time. Well, will the real God please stand up? But I want you to know that the same God who loves, the same God who cares about you, the same God that sent his only begotten Son to die for you, to take your sins upon himself, will one day be your judge. There's a story about a guy that went before the court, and he noticed the judge, and he realized that the judge was the same man that had helped him on the side of the road when his car was broken down. This man stopped and helped him out. And now we were standing before him. And so as we were standing there, he said, "Your Honor, you remember me? You helped me when I was in distress. I didn't know what to do with the situation I was in, and you came along and you helped me. Now I stand before you. I ask for your leniency." And the judge said, "On that day when I stepped out to help you, I was your friend. But today, I'm your judge." And so the same one that sent his only begotten Son to die on the cross for your sin is one day going to be your judge based on what you did with the Lord Jesus Christ and the plan of salvation that God has designed for you. Right now, the gates of heaven are open to you. Right now, the gift of eternal life is open to you. God is showing his love and drawing you to himself. But God, who is a God of love, is also a just God and is going to judge what we have done with Christ and how we have accepted him as a Savior. That's a very solemn thing. You know, we who live in America think everybody is Christian. But do you know that India is filled with Hindu people that believe in 1,000 gods? None of their gods will save them. Millions of people who are Muslims who are following after Mohammed. But Mohammed cannot save them. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." And so it's very clear that God has one plan for salvation, one door that we can come through, and Jesus is that door. Now, people call us narrow-minded because we believe that Jesus is the only way. But let's not be afraid of what we're going to be called. As long as we are agreeing with the Word of God, as long as we are aligning ourselves up with God's Word and truth, then we're on the right path. The Bible says that the road to destruction, the road to hell, is a wide, wide road. It will accept everybody. Come on, we're going to have fun. Serve this God, worship this God. You choose the God that you want to serve. The road to destruction is wide and very accepting. And the Bible says that the road to heaven is a narrow road, and few there be that find it. So for people that think that everybody's going to go to heaven, you're not agreeing with the Word of God, because that's contrary to what the Bible says. Now, what I want to share with us today is that, what does that do for you? If you know you're on the narrow road, that leads a life? What are you doing for others that are on the wide road leading to destruction? Do we care? Does it bother us? Can you sleep well at night knowing that many people are on the wide road that are leading to hell? And I believe that part of what I want to share with you is to challenge you. Challenge you to not be complacent. To challenge you to live on the edge and care about people in your family. Care about people that you work with. Care about people that are in your world. And pray for them and ask the Holy Spirit to open your heart to be able to minister to them. God so loves the world. And so because of his love for the world, we ought to love the same world that he loves. And love, ask him to love through us to a lost and dying generation. A generation that's coming up now that does not know about God. They have not been raised, even in America, to honor God. Taking the Bible out of school, they're taking prayer out of school. They don't want our kids to be influenced by God or by the world. And so the longer we live that way, the more we're going to see corruption take place, anarchy, mob rule, and we are fast becoming a society that is so anti-God and so much about me and so me conscious. And if I'm offended, then I'm going to join the mob that is offended. And more people today are feeling offended and are joining the mob and fighting against society. But God has a plan for us. Now, I've really lost my way here. So let me see if I can get back where I want to be. If hell is not real and everyone is going to get to go to heaven eventually, we might as well close the doors of the church and go home. It was not a high priority for us to keep our relationship with God clean and pure and allow the Holy Spirit to move in us. If there are no consequences for sin, then let everybody live the way they want to, because there is no tomorrow. But because we believe there is an eternity, we believe that there's an eternity. If there's no consequences for disobedience to the law of God, then what incentive does man have to do what's right? If everybody goes to heaven and there are no consequences for sin, then God is not going to reward anybody for doing right. If there's no consequences, then let's all just do what we want to do. We can close the doors of the church and let the world go to hell. The Bible speaks about the fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord. In Psalm 111, verse 10, it says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all those who do his commandments. His praise endures forever. Psalm 25, verse 14 says, the secret of the Lord is for those who fear him, and he will make them known, but know his covenant. And so, because we preach on God's love, where does the fear of the Lord come? Why do I want you to be afraid of God? We sing the song, I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. We sing it better than I do, but you get the message. And so why would I want to be afraid of my friend? The fear of the Lord comes from the fact that one day we're going to stand before him as a judge. And that strikes a chord in our heart. Let me use this as an example. You grow up growing up in a family, you know your father and your mother love you. They have shown their love to you, they provide for you, they give to you, they feed you, they clothe you, they take care of you. Make sure you go to school, everything. They love you. But there's also a time when we are not obedient to them. And when you're not obedient to him, you go home and you wonder what the consequences are going to be. Because dad is going to take off his belt and you're going to get spanked. Why? Because you were disobedient. Because you did not choose your father's way. Now, just because he punishes you for not being obedient, does that mean that he does not love you? No. He loves you enough to chastise you. He loves you enough to discipline you so that you develop character in your life. But when we know that we've been disobedient, we'd rather not come home from school. We'll find something else to do. We'll go over to a friend's house and we spend more time there. Why? Because of our fear of dad. We're afraid of what he's going to do. What if we've been obedient and we've done all the chores that we're supposed to do and kept our room clean and have done well? Then there's no fear. And so for us as believers, we know that one day we're going to face God as our judge, and he's going to judge us at the end of life. And because of that, I develop this awe. I develop this respect for God, knowing that one day I'm going to have to give an account of all the things that I've said, all the things that I've done. And so it's a healthy fear. It's a healthy fear that we have in our relationship with God that helps us. And so we want to develop that awe of God. That comes from the knowledge that one day, okay, that part, Colossians 3, verse 5. It's in your notes. Therefore, consider the members of your earthly body as dead to immorality, impurity, passion, evil desires, and greed, which amounts to idolatry. For it is because of these things that the wrath of God will come upon the sons of disobedience. And in them you also once walked when you were living in them. But now you also put them aside: anger, wrath, malice, slander, abusive speech. Do not lie to one another, since you laid aside the old self with its evil practices. And so all through the New Testament we're told the things that are pleasing to God, and we're told the things that are displeasing to him. We need to take heed of those things. We need to take heed of the things that we do that are displeasing to him. If we continue to walk in those things, those areas of our life that are displeasing to him, and not without asking him to help us to overcome, then we distance ourselves from him. We distance ourselves from his love. and eventually we lose sight of him. But God wants us to draw near. God wants us to draw close to him. And so as we learn to walk in obedience to his word, which is by ourselves totally impossible, it's impossible for us to live in such a way that is pleasing to God, except that Christ is in us and he gives us the grace to overcome in every area of the life. I don't care what your life consists of. I don't care what bondage you have been in. The grace of God and the love of God in you can help you to be an overcomer. Can help you to be victorious in this life. The Bible says that the power of sin has been broken over you. Now, some of you are looking at me cross-eyed. You're saying in your mind, boy, I don't know where he lives, but to me, living an a victorious Christian life is one of the hardest things that I will ever do. And the reason that is because you're trying to do it yourself. I'm trying to overcome. I'm trying to train myself. I'm trying to discipline myself. And the Bible says that what we should be doing is submitting ourselves. Instead of trying to overcome sin ourselves, allow the grace of God to work in me. Allow the grace of God to work within me. Because the grace of God in you is the power to cause you to be an overcomer. The grace of God is greater than all of your sin. The grace of God that has the power to break whatever bondage you might be in. You do not have to live your life in bondage to sin. Because the Bible says that when you got saved, the power of sin over you was broken. And the reason why some people struggle so hard trying to be good, if I could just be good enough to please God, that's all in vain, because we're leaning on our own arm, we're leaning on our own understanding, and we're not putting our trust in God. There is so much power in asking God to forgive us. Say, oh, Pastor, how many times do I have to ask for forgiveness? Well, let me say this. Every day. You know, the Lord's Prayer says, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive those who were indebted to. In other words, forgive me of my sin. Now, the Lord's Prayer was to be prayed every day. Maybe not the words, but the meaning of the Lord's Prayer, the outline, the truth of it, is something that we need to do every day. We pray, Lord, give us this day our daily bread. It doesn't say give us our monthly groceries. It doesn't say take care of me for a few months. But he wants us to come to him every single day and participate in his plan of grace. His grace is his goodness. His goodness working in you. And as you open your heart up to his goodness, the grace of God comes in and gives you the power. He gives you the power. I said, he is the one that gives you the power. the being overcomer. And so what you find is that when you enter into God's plan of grace and you humble yourself every day before Him and confess your sins before Him every day and yield yourself every day to His plan and submit yourself to Him every day, then you are participating in His grace, and His grace now starts to do its work in you. His grace does that work of giving you the power over whatever besetting sin you have. And the longer we do that, we find that there are some things that fall off. Hindrances. Problems that I used to have with my thought life. Problems that I had trouble with in my life, they start to drop off. Not because I focus on the sin, but because I focus on the grace. I focus on His goodness working in me. And as we learn how to do that, that He gives us the power to be an overcomer. In Revelation 20:10, He says that those who follow the ways of the world will be cast into the lake of burning sulfur and be tormented day and night. Hell is a place where those who are condemned will never find rest. No sleep will come to them. Matthew 25, this is in your notes, verse 41. It says, "Then He will also say to those on His left, 'Depart from me, accursed ones, into eternal fire, which has been prepared for the devil and his angels.'" Now let's focus on Luke chapter 16. Now, it says, "Now there was a certain rich man." This is not a parable. This is actually something that happened. If it was a parable, he would have said, you know, there wouldn't be any names. But this is actually what's happening. It was not a story that Jesus was telling them. And so there was a certain rich man, and he habitually dressed in purple and fine linen, joyously living in splendor every day. Now, it doesn't say that he was a murderer. Doesn't say that he was a thief. Doesn't say that he was a rapist. Doesn't say that he lived a terrible life. All he did say was that he lived a good life. How many people today are so comfortable in their circumstance that they don't need God? I don't need God. How did you come to Christ? Most of you would say that I came because of a tragedy. I came because I was in a crisis. My life was falling apart. Most people come because we recognize our need of God. How many would say that's true of your life? You came to Christ because of a crisis in your life. Sure. So many. And so this man never saw his need of God. I never saw that I needed Christ. And so he was in control of his life and everything was fine. And a poor man, verse 20, "And a poor man named Lazarus was laid at his gate, covered with sores, and longing to be fed with the crumbs which were falling from the rich man's table, because even the dogs were coming and licking his sores. Now the poor man died and was carried away by angels to Abraham's bosom. And the rich man also died and was buried." In Hades, or in hell, he lifted up his eyes, being in torment, and saw Abraham far away, and Lazarus was in his bosom. And he cried out and said, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me. Send Lazarus so that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool off my tongue, for I am in agony in flames. Verse 25. But Abraham said, Child, remember that during your life you received your good things, and likewise Lazarus had bad things. But now he is being comforted here, and you are in agony. You get a little picture of hell when you read that. And besides all this, between us and you, there's a great chasm fixed, so that those who wish to come over from here to you will not be able to, and that none may cross over from there to us. He said, Then I beg you, Father, that you send to him my father's host, for I have five brothers, in order that he may warn them, so that they will not also come to this place of torment. But Abraham said, They have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. But he said, No, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent. But he said to them, If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, they will not be persuaded even if one of them rises from the dead. Hell is not a place where anybody wants to go. But hell is going to be filled with people who did not hearken the voice of God and did not accept God's plan for salvation. They were full of themselves. And today, I would say that the majority of people here are on the way to heaven. You have that security in Christ. I know you're not perfect, but you know the grace of God, and the grace of God is working in your life. And so maybe I'm preaching to the choir tonight. So here's what we can do. What about people out there? What about your family? What about your friends that don't know Christ? Why do we have a mission program? We just had a mission convention a couple weeks ago. We're talking about people that we send out from this church, and we support them every month. And we send them to Haiti, and we send them to Peru, and we send them to Costa Rica, and we send them to Russia, and we send them to Japan, and we send them to Mongolia, and we send them to Mexico, and we send out people. Why? Because for God so loved the world, our responsibility, you know, what is our theme? Love God, love each other, and love the world. And if we don't love the world that is filled with sin, if we don't love the world, then we cannot be the church that Jesus came to build. And so I ask you this morning, how much do you love the world? How much do you love unbelievers? How much do you really love people that are on their way to hell? Does it bother you? Do you ever think about people around you that are not going to heaven? Do you care about that? Part of our living in submission to God and to his world is to have a heart that breaks for lost people, lost family members, lost neighbors, lost people that we work with. If they had an opportunity at the end of life, would those that are in hell come back to you and say, Why didn't you tell me? You had the answer for life, but you never told me. And so I challenge you today to care for the lost, to go after them, to allow the Holy Spirit to lead you, even to make that your prayer. Lord, today I want a divine encounter with somebody that does not know you. I want to be able to tell somebody about your love. I want to be able to extend to people the fact that God has a plan for the salvation. So I ask you that, to take that today and to make that a part of your life. If you are not showing that you care for the lost, then ask God to change your heart. Ask God to give you a heart for lost people so that you're driven from within. You're driven to love people enough to love them into the kingdom of God. Let's pray. Bow our head. So, Lord, we've become comfortable knowing that we're on our way to heaven, knowing that heaven is our home, and we're satisfied. And we've been lulled to sleep, knowing that we're going to heaven. But I pray today that there will be an awakening. Awaken us to the reality of our real hell. Wake us up to the reality that many of our family and friends are on their way to hell. I pray that it will bother us. I pray that sleep will not come to our eyes because of people around us going to hell. I pray for a holy stirring within us to bring us to that place we call care about lost people. I pray, Lord, you help us. Before we close this service, I'm going to ask you about your own personal relationship with God through Jesus. Are you certain today that you're going to heaven? Are you certain today that Christ lives within you? Do you have the confidence that you are born again, child of God, and that you are in right standing with him, that you live a forgiven lifestyle? Notice I did not say that you live a perfect life, but I'm saying you live a forgiven life. And if you're confident that you're on the way to heaven, I wonder how many of you are here today and say, I need to accept Christ as my Savior. I need to open my heart to him. I need to begin my spiritual journey today. With your head bowed and your eyes closed, if you would like to become a follower of Christ, just raise your hand. Let me see that God is dealing with your heart. And you don't know if you would go to heaven, but you want to know. Anybody here this morning? Anybody here? God is touching your heart. God is touching your heart. And you want to get saved. You want to give your life to Christ. Let's all stand, shall we? I'm going to ask for our prayer team will come and take your place. Maybe you didn't want to raise your hand. Maybe you thought I was going to make a spectacle of you. I'm not here to try to embarrass you. But because of God's love, I love you. I want to see you become a part of His great plan in your life. And so if you don't know Christ as Savior, when everybody leaves, you come down front. Or if you need special prayer, you say, I've got a struggle in my life. I'm struggling in this area of my life, and I need someone to pray with me. Then these people here will agree with you in prayer, and God will do a great work in your life. Don't forget that tonight at 7 o'clock is our last showing. Father, we thank you for your love and goodness. I pray, Lord, that what has been said today will strike us. I pray that we'll be shaken on the inside. I pray that we'll have divine encounters this week, that you will connect us with people that are ready to get saved. Go with us as we go. Bring us back together tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Those that need prayer, please come.